The Big Dog. The Big Dog. The Bergdon. Or as he's known today, the Tribal Chief. WWE have finally figured out a main event level gig for Roman Reigns that showcases his many talents that will make a bunch of money and that actually excites us about the Universal Championship for the first time in God 4 years. But bloody hell, the course never did run smooth. The whole Big Dog experiment made WWE genuinely feel like the goddamn Twilight Zone at times. And to be clear, this is not a list that's going to dump on Reigns as a performer. Not interested in that, because remember, no superstar has a perfect game except for Keith Lee, of course. It is and always has been WWE's job to present their stars in a way that showcases their positives and hides their negatives in order to generate fan support. And on that front, over the years, they have repeatedly failed the large pup. Gonna try and keep this at 10. Pray for mojo. Here are the 10 worst mistakes WWE made with Roman Reigns. And hey, if you haven't yet, go subscribe to Parts Fun Known. In a few weeks, all the future lists are gonna be uploaded there instead of to WrestleTalk. We're making sure only news gets uploaded to WrestleTalk, whereas all of our fun, silly, evergreen content like fantasy bookings and these lists will be moving over to Parts Fun Known instead. Long story short, I live over at Parts Fun Known now, so if you want to see me and my stuff, click the link in the description, go subscribe over there, and make sure you never miss one of these silly wrestling lists ever again. Number 10, Baby Blues. You know how since Tangled, all the Disney princesses have had the same exact face because money somehow? Well, for the longest time, Roman was WWE's Disney princess, and for some reason, they made him wear blue contact lenses because, of course, this man is not handsome with brown eyes. No handsome here. Definitely not a biscuit. Wouldn't f*** this guy, no sir. It may seem like a small point, but it's emblematic of a larger issue at play, which was Roman feeling way more like a product than a person. That's what John Cena was talking about when he went all pew pew shooty tooty, calling Reigns corporately created. Sure, give your superstars an iconic outfit, but when it comes to actively going in and changing their creator wrestler's save file to make them more toyetic, that's when it becomes uncanny and we start to see the committee under the skin stripping Roman of his agency and relatability. And speaking of Big Match John, number 9, Big Match Gone. Roman Reigns versus John Cena happened on pay-per-view, and you know what? It was good. Not as good as it would have been if Roman had been over, but it was good. Which Big Four pay-per-view did that happen at again? Oh, that's right, No Mercy, in front of a gate of 16,000 people instead of, you know, a stadium or something. Look, no one knows the future. I get it. In 2017, you don't know if John Cena can be relied upon to come back after such hits as Playing With Fire and Daddy's Home 2, Two Dads, Too Dubious. And hey, maybe Roman's as over as he's ever gonna get, so run the program while you still can. Except that the face that runs the place versus the head of the table right now could be the moneyest match in WWE's immediate future, but because Reigns has already gone over Cena clean as a sheet, the match's drawing power drastic go down. Thank heaven WWE still have Rock Roman in their back pocket. Number 8, One Man Band. 2014 was a pretty excellent year for WWE story-wise. Daniel Bryan won at WrestleMania, Suplex City became super hot fire, and Shield broke up in spectacular fashion. In fact, there's an argument to be made that WWE haven't been able to top that year since, because that was when the weird Big Dog thing started in earnest, and a lot of that has to do with how one of the greatest factions in wrestling history fell apart. The Shield imploded and Rollins got a new attitude, outfit, entrance theme and direction. Dean Ambrose got a new outfit, entrance theme and direction, and Roman's just sort of stayed the Shield guy. Same fatigues, only with a super radical Prince meets Monster Energy drink style logo on the front. Same music, same pretty much everything. Dean and Seth emerged from the ashes of the Shield, fundamentally changed by its destruction because, yeah, it was a pretty big deal, and WWE just promoted Roman to the main event, saying, look, it's a Shield. You guys like the Shield, right? Do-do. Come on, everyone, do-do. And we're like, no, we liked the Shield. They were a team. Who's that guy? He's the Shield, said WWE. No, said fans. Who is that one man? What is his character? Haha, said WWE. Big Dog, like the Hounds of Justice, but one of them. That was Roman for the longest time, just recognizable branding, a man who couldn't move on like someone doing Gangnam Style today. Number 7, doing Dean dirty. We sort of touched on this, but it needs its own entry because the fact that the Shield triple threat did not happen at WrestleMania 31 or at the very least SummerSlam 2014 is absolutely baffling. It's so weird looking back on it now that Roman was the guy who was still wearing the Shield colors, coming out to the Shield song, but he actually had the least to do with the fallout of the breakup. The very next pay-per-view after the Shield, remember the biggest faction wrestling at the time, had been destroyed by cruel and hideous betrayal at Money in the Bank. Seth and Dean got into it and Roman was in a ladder match for the vacant WWE World Championship. I mean, gee, sure, Roman, chase that paper. Sure, Roman fought Randy at SummerSlam and got pulled from a match with Rollins later on because of a hernia, but still, Roman left Dean behind before the story was finished. If Roman isn't presented to care about his brotherhood with Dean Ambrose and his hatred of Seth Rollins, how can we care about Roman and his weird, emotionless race to the top? Number 6, the 2015 Rumble. F***ing obviously. So as we all know, this is where it went really, really wrong, when Roman Reigns fundamentally broke as a product. Try and imagine, if you can, a WrestleMania where the card is Triple H versus Sting, The Shield Triple Threat, and Daniel Bryan versus Brock Lesnar. I would buy that for a dollar. The main event wasn't finished with Daniel Bryan, just like Roman Reigns should not have been finished with Rollins and Ambrose, and WWE bafflingly, bewilderingly brought Daniel Bryan back to television before the Rumble. F***ing why? You didn't have to. If Roman had to win the Rumble, the last thing you want is the most over underdog of the last generation, the man who didn't lose his world championship, who only just returned after a career-threatening injury, suddenly back a viable and in fact perfect contender to win the Royal Rumble. Mistake one, right there, up front. And then they eliminate Bryan early to try and make fans grieve and move on. That didn't work before having the worst final stretch in Royal Rumble history of Big Show and Kane grandpaing people over the top rope. Anti-Roman sentiment has mostly never been about Roman. It boils down to this one time where he was not the right guy, fans didn't get a choice, and wrestling fans hold f***ing grudges. Number 5, the 2016 Rumble. Jesus Christ. Oh, this one's just funny to look back on. So at some point during 2015, Roman developed canine narcolepsy, and WWE's favorite thing became have Roman get beaten down, have a nice long nap, then return for the end. At SummerSlam 2015, in a match with Reigns and Ambrose versus The Wyatt, Reigns got knocked down and stayed lying down for, no joke, over 5 minutes. So much so that the fans started chanting, Roman sleeping. First of all, that is hilarious in a nothing matters kind of way. And then at the 2016 Rumble, a Rumble that was, remember, built around Roman going the distance, coming in at number one, lasting right till the end in order to cling on to his WWE Championship. WWE had him attacked, removed from the match without being eliminated, gave him a nice snooze backstage in his little basket like a good papa before coming out for the end. Literally, WWE fans told WWE, we do not buy this man as the best wrestler. WWE responded, oh, well, we'll have him wrestle less. Then you'll see. So daft. All the time. Number 4, slow dads are forever. The main event of WrestleMania 32 was awful. Just a big dog worse. Like a match the fans didn't want, an end result the fans didn't want, because they will not forgive Roman. And to top it off, it went half an hour of heatless misery circling the drain of the Roman coronation. Like if Roman had speared Steph, speared Trips, was done in 5 and then back to the Winchester to have a nice cold pint to wait for all this to blow over, then at least it would have been quick. Half an hour, and all it does is poison the fans further against Roman as a main eventer, because he isn't a bad wrestler, certainly isn't today, and wasn't a bad wrestler then. But if fans are fundamentally opposed to a match, that match will be bad, even if it's short. But by dragging it out, angering everyone so much more, boring them so much more, this just furthered that false narrative that Reigns was a terrible wrestler who should never main event WrestleMania because bad things happen when he does. Completely unfair to the lad. Number 3, with enemies like these. Hogan had Piper, Andre and Savage. The Rock had Triple H, Austin had Mr. McMahon. A top babyface is only as good as the villains that he overcomes. Who are Roman's top villains? Who helped to define him? Who is the Joker to his Batman? Rollins was never really given that spot. Bray Wyatt, who'd been off the boil for over a year. Brock, maybe, but he's been dealing with his own fan backlash since 2016 or so. Genuinely the only person that comes to mind who had something close to an enduring rivalry with Roman, something that could have elevated both men, was Braun Strowman. Then WWE nerfed him beyond belief so that the Shield could do some more six-man tag team matches. WWE repeatedly failed to build up good villains with consistently strong booking to really challenge Roman or put him through the kind of adversity that really builds character. It sure didn't happen with Baron Corbin and f***ing dog food. Not that it would have really mattered anyway, because number 2, laugh it up, fuzzball. WWE babyfaces suck. Apart from a select few, they are all the same guy, and that guy sucks. And has ever since that guy's name was John Cena, or Seth Rollins, or Dean Ambrose, or Sheamus, or any of the other babyface world champions whose sole contribution to a main event feud is, I'm not really bothered or threatened or engaged in any actual emotional way. My opponent's poopy though. Look at him, he's got weird nips, or a sparkle crotch, or tater tot, or suffering succotash. It's not just just that those lines are lame and only a lame, insecure, unfunny asshole would say them. It's the fact that none of these baby faces care about anything. That being glib is their biggest virtue. You know why people like Daniel Bryan? Because he cared about stuff. When he got mistreated, he got fucking pissed about it. And when he failed, it got to him, and that gave his villains agency. Sami Zayn had the same fire in NXT. Hell, it's why Cena's best years were his last in the company, when he started cutting serious, impassioned promos about fucking angry he was. It's why Kevin Owens is the best babyface going right now. It didn't matter to WWE that during his Shield days, Roman had already gotten over as a man of few words. That's what he was good at. But no, he's the top babyface now, and he was going to do the WWE top babyface things, whether they suited him or not. And really, that's what it all boils down to. Number one, the Hulk Hogan problem. Not like those problems. You know the ones I mean. I mean the idea that in some form or another, WWE still operates the way it did during the 80s. Have one top guy and have him carry your company. People step up, but they're all set down under the big boot of the one top Superman. They tried it with Luger, Diesel, Austin, Cena, Roman. You could argue that it worked under Austin, but was it because Austin was the one top guy? Or was it because the Attitude Era had Austin, Rock, Triple H, Foley, Undertaker? Point is, it's never really been about Roman Reigns. It's been about the fact that WWE seems to think there's only room for one person in the main event of WrestleMania, and that one person has to be Roman Reigns for a generation, because it makes everything else feel redundant. It makes when other superstars get lightning hot an inconvenience to WWE rather than a blessing. It makes the fans getting behind someone new feel like a wasted exercise, despite WWE repeatedly telling us apparently we're the authority now. When there's only room for one guy to carry the company on his back, every other part of the creative process suffers, especially the guy who's been put in that position. The big dog. And that's our list. What do you think are the biggest mistakes WWE made with Roman Reigns? Let us know in the comments. Don't forget to like and share this video around. And if you haven't already, make sure you subscribe to Parts Funknown, the new home of all our lists. And never forget to jam that jam.